Hello, my name is Cal Molinet from Richmond, Virginia, and I'm an anarchist.
It's about time you finally came out and said it.
I admit it, I'm out of the closet, have nothing to hide.
I'm Matt Badaglioli, I know Austrian economics.
Yes, and so he's also, in addition to the Liberate RVA economist here, he's very well-versed and also in Austrian economics.
And so, yeah, anything to do with sound money, wages, prices, labor, scarcity. Wage regulations, labor regulations, all that stuff, yeah.
Yeah, to defuse the lies and bullshit that you're taught here about what is economics here, Keynesian economics, of course, and these VCU public school settings. So, of course, with that, hopefully I see you guys tomorrow at the Analyzing Capitalism event. We're going to have, a nomenclature workshop on understanding what our firearms before our field trip training, and we're going to lighting the fire pit finally for this year. So, with that, see you guys at the 50 party. Take good care.
And at the same time, governments need to fund it to more violence, because no point can say, I do want to help the poor, but I don't want to fund war, right? You have no freedom of economic choice. You still have to give them your money. You still have to give up your property. You still have to pay your taxes. Because if you did have a freedom of economic choice of what to do with your own property, government wouldn't threaten to send you to another cage if you didn't pay your taxes. So that's the immorality. That's the hidden violence behind government. And that this organization only knows how to solve problems through one way, a singular way, and that's through the threat of and use of violence to solve any problems, versus the plurality of non-violent solutions that us three here already share. So what are your thoughts on that?
I absolutely agree.
Yeah?
Yeah, there you go. Politicians are, corrupt and in it for their careers, basically. So
right? At your expense, right? It's not a real job.
Yeah, it's not a real job just to tell you what to do with your life.
What do you aim to do?
Right? So, like, before you're coming here, you're talking, you've had some libertarian leanings. And how do you express that? What are your thoughts on, having no government then? I mean, so we can still have rules, right? But how do you view what is government?
Well, I think it should definitely be at the state level more than the federal level. Leave it up to the states what they want to do.
Right.
Would you feel like you have an advocation for the free market businesses to solve solutions instead?
Yeah.
Right? All right, so then we can step back a little further. What government is objectively is that they have a monopoly on the services you and I want, us three want, right? Everyone wants. I want roads, I want security, I want first class mail. I guess email is better, of course, but I want, courts and law and all this sort of stuff, but these particular areas are what government has monopolized. You have no economic freedom to cancel or subscribe as you would like Netflix, right? Netflix raised their prices 2 years ago, people cancel and subscribe, went to Hulu, right? But when government raises their prices, like in the cost of stamps, you still can't unsubscribe, right? Nor do you have the freedom to compete entrepreneurially against that monopolized service, right? So I guess when you look at that, what is government objectively? They have a monopoly on these services that businesses could provide if there's competition at a lower cost, better quality. What do you think about, re-examining that?
Should definitely re-examine it.
Right?
Free market economy builds competitiveness and better products. So.
And it's voluntary, it's consensual, there's no, because you're born in here, you you're stuck with AT&T with the rest of your life, right?
Yeah.
Like Social Security, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you never gave consent to that, you never signed that, you're a baby, but you're forced to pay for that, and when it's time for you to withdraw a check, it's like there'll be nothing left for you, right? Because you have a good background, so I understand. What's your background? What are you here studying for?
I'm a history major.
You're a history major. Oh,
awesome.
Nice.
Well, my dad works for the John Birch Society. I don't know.
Right? Bit of a cringe name.
Yeah. People have some bad ideas about them, but I read libertarian publications I don't know if you guys heard of Talking Magazine.
Yeah, I have.
That's my favorite place to go. And, I don't know.
What do you think about the UN?
UN? Not a fan.
I think you're not.
Yeah.
You're John Birch. I don't think. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's cool. So you're talking about government on a state level versus a federal level. So if you can have, without living in a state of chaos, the states in Canada, so America and Canada are separate from each other, and then New York separate from the federal state of America, then why not then Manhattan from New York, or one street, one neighborhood, one person? Where does the chain of non-chaos break? Why?
I mean, if someone doesn't want to be a part of society, I guess it's their right.
Yeah, sure.
If that ends up being a large group, a large community, that's their business.
Exactly.
Shouldn't be forced to pay taxes or participate in whatever's going on.
Right.
So, I guess that's my thought. Correct.
Have you heard of Tom Woods?
Oh, yes.
You have? Yeah, okay. Hard, yeah. Nice. High five for that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh,
Mises.
Okay, the Mises Institute.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Oh, that's cool. That's awesome. That's awesome. I guess that's pretty much what we're doing out here, trying to, I guess, dispel some of these myths of government, that they're like the savior of our society, and they do nothing but the opposite. We're part of an organization called Liberate, it's a non-political organization, libertarian, classical libertarianism, or free market anarchism. Have you ever heard those terms?
Yeah.
You have? Really? Okay, cool.
Anarcho-Capitalism. Tom Woods is.
Well, yeah, I would imagine, but sometimes Tom Woods is not so
new about
vocal.
The Mises Institute.
Okay, there we go. No, that's awesome. That's cool. Well, my name is Cal.
I'm Brad.
Brad?
Yeah.
You like some pamphlets?
Sure.
Yeah? Okay, cool. Well, we'll pass this one out and this one.
Sure. Yeah, you know Judge Andrew Palladino?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he was my con law clerk.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. Where did you go to?
Jesus. From here?
Oh, yeah.
I'm 19, and I was a freshman for a little while.
Okay.
I didn't like it here, so I kind of just went to another school. But I'm still around here doing this. There you go.
Yeah, so you'll find a lot of familiar sources. On, like, in the back of the pamphlets, they'll have, like, free market anarchist sources. So, like, you heard, like, David Freeman, Tom Woods, Bob Murphy. So a lot of familiar, I guess, areas of Austrian economics. Have you heard of that term?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, okay. All right, cool. No, I don't want to presuppose,
Yeah.
Oh, that's pretty cool. That's awesome. So you're studying it for history, huh?
Yeah.
What do you want to do with that?
Well, I thought I wanted to teach, but I changed my mind on that.
After going to school, you decided you don't want to be in that position.
You'll be forced to read their textbooks, right?
Yeah.
That's kind of goes against, like, wanted to teach, examples of past patterns. I guess that's what you will call history. Pretty cool. So what do you want to do with that now?
I don't know. I was thinking about doing, like, a park ranger type thing.
Yeah?
Or working out, like, Battlefield or something.
Right.
No,
that's pretty cool. Well, thanks for stopping by, man.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Nice seeing you guys.
You as well. So that's the hidden violence behind government, and that this organization only knows how to solve problems the one way, a singular way, and that's through the threat of and use of violence to solve any problems, versus so the plurality of nonviolent solutions that us three here already share. So what are your thoughts on that?
Absolutely. I mean, it's insane that, like, our government has felt the need to try and regulate every single part of our lives.
Right.
I always thought this country was founded on the idea that, you know, the individual is responsible and, intelligent enough to care for themselves.
Right.
Well, and then you think there's a contradiction even in that. People who will say that they're not will still have them vote for decisions that affect you.
True.
So they can't make decisions for themselves, they can make decisions for everybody else.
True, I guess. I mean, it's one of the paradoxes of democracy. It's supposed to be everybody gets together, but it's mostly everybody gets together and tells everybody.
The majority over the minority, right?
Yeah.
So would you say you feel free?
In America?
Are you free today?
Really.
Right, you're free to do as what you're told to do, right?
Yeah.
Right, and that's it by politicians, right?
I mean, like you said, I'm free, but if I smoke a plant, I go to jail.
You go to jail.
If I try to marry someone who's the same gender as me, I can't.
Do you want to opt out of a universal security retirement plan? Do you want to figure I can't do that?
And the reason why government got involved in the Marriage Act to begin with was to prevent interracial marriages. That's the origin, that's the history behind that. To prevent white people from marrying black people of different ethnicities. So you'll find that very at its heart and center is very bigoted. It's the last thing you would want. Like, it discriminates in that form and sense.
Yeah, I mean, it's just... I mean, the government, it's like... I don't know if I would describe myself as anarchist. I am familiar with it.
Yeah?
It does appeal to me.
Well, we're free market anarchists.
I really identify with that.
Yeah?
I mean, it's a really interesting philosophy. I'm still trying to work out.
Okay. All right. So let's make this easier then.
Okay.
So what government is objectively? All governments in the world. They have a monopoly on the services you and I want.
Yeah.
Right? They have a monopoly on law. They have a monopoly on courts, on judges, on roads, on security. USPS, they have a monopoly on delivering pieces of paper. It is illegal and criminal for USPS, for UPS and FedEx to deliver pieces of paper. They're only allowed to deliver packages.
Yeah.
Right? They have a monopoly on currency. They have a monopoly here in the tax for Virginia on distilled spirits, ABC. You have no freedom to cancel or unsubscribe as you would any other service. Right? To cancel or unsubscribe, right? Like Netflix, try to raise the prices overnight, people's like, oh, fuck that, cancel or unsubscribe, I'm going to Hulu.
right? Yeah. Or yeah. Prime Wire, you know, streaming these shows. Yeah. Nor do you have the freedom to compete entrepreneurially against these monopolized services. In order to say, I can provide you a better service security, it's not going to be harmful or abusive to you, the consumer. I'm not going to throw you into a cage for a victimless crime.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, if I don't like, you know, Coke or Intel, I just won't buy them.
Right, yeah. Thank you, but that's
the whole
edge.
Thing, if you can understand that.
I mean, I really hate the government's policy for drones.
Right.
Yeah. So, like, well, I won't pay my taxes, so they don't have the money to do it. Well, too bad.
Too bad. We're going to throw you in a cage. Anyway. Right.
Yeah, it's crazy. I don't know.
And that's really all free market anarchism is, or anarcho-capitalism.
Yeah.
It's a respect for property rights. You own your own body. You own your the resources you claim titleship ownership of, right?
Yeah.
And every interaction is just voluntary and consensual. You have, these will be based on contracts, right? You have no contract with government.
Yeah.
Right, which is why they could say, well, we're just going to pass you the bill for you and raise your taxes every other year, you know? And there's nothing you can't say or do or cancel or unsubscribe, right?
Well, they have a contract called Shotgun. Yeah. That's a contract.
Oh, that's great, man. That's great. Self-defense, your first line of self-defense is you. But even the Supreme Court has ruled that the police here have no constitutional duty to provide that defense for you, unless you're in their custody, being detained, right? So you don't even have a contract for them to protect you. Right? So what you'll find in a free and voluntary society, you have a plurality of nonviolent solutions, like we said in the beginning. You have polycentric legal system, real contracts. It's like when you move to an apartment complex that says, you know, cats are law, but dogs are not. It's like, oh, I agree to that contract, right?
Yeah.
So that's what you would have. I agree to the consequences,
you have
right?
Formal consent, too, with your signature.
You have no contract with the Constitution.
Yeah, when you're born, that's basically your signature right there.
Right. It's like, what? It's like, oh, my God, that's not a signature.
Yeah.
But they'll say it is. They'll say it's implied consent.
Being born.
Being born, being a baby. It's like babies cannot give consent to contracts. What kind of idea is that?
Yeah, that's crazy.
But that's what we do. We're part of a non-political organization here. Trying to turn to our community and away from politics and government.
Yeah.
We got pamphlets if you like.
That's sweet.
Yeah.
All right, cool.
And we have a newsletter if you want to meet other market anarchists.
Oh,
see
what
they.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, cool. All right. Well, that's awesome. I'm Cal, by the way.
I'm Alex.
Alex, pleasure to meet you. And at the same time, governments even funded through more violence. Because at no point can you say, I do want to help the poor, but I don't want to fund war. Right? You have no freedom of economic choice. You still have to give me your money. You still have to give up your property. You still have to pay your taxes. Because if you did have a freedom of economic choice of what to do with your own property, government wouldn't threaten to send you to another cage if you didn't pay your taxes. Right? So that's the second, that's the hidden bias behind government, that this organization only knows how to solve problems through one way, a singular way, and that's through the threat of and use of violence to solve any problems, versus the plurality, though, of non-violent solutions that us three here already share.
So do you think that violence, as it is expressed by bureaucracy, would be oppressive regulation?
Yeah.
Yes, that's a good way of putting it.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, they're legislating their opinions.
Or oppressive rule of law, maybe more accurate.
Yeah, they have a monopoly on law.
Sure.
Right? They don't allow us to have, like, thousands of rich, diverse communities that can have a polysacred legal system, that you have real tacit consent and agreement and contract to that law, right? We don't have
what
that.
What is tacit?
Tacit, like, explicit. I mean, explicit.
Okay.
Explicit agreement, right?
Okay.
Like, a contract.
I'm just not familiar
with like a contract with your car payments is an explicit agreement, a contract, or with a house mortgage or a landlord, right? I'm going to sign no cats allowed, got it, right? with Netflix, right? For this month, I'm going to give you a title ownership of my money, and you're going to provide me streaming entertainment, right?
Yeah.
But with government, you have no contract. You have nothing consensual in agreement towards that with government. It's not explicit. You can't even find it.
Well, I think that it's a birthright. It's kind of contradictory to say the birthright, because it's imposed upon the individual.
Right? So that's not consensual.
But you know, they identify that as the value of freedom and as the luxury of American life and such. They being the executives and the authorities of American regulation.
They'll say, well, you were born here. It's like, are you implying that babies can give consent? It's like, are you taking that position, really, that babies gave consent to their contract? Yeah. Like, oh, that's kind of weird to take up, right?
They're projecting the privilege through our voices that are yet to develop as, you know, we are developing.
Flowery words.
Sugar-coated a lot, but.
Yeah, and they'll say, like, well, the social contract, you can't point to it. It doesn't exist, right? I want something
it's
tangible.
It's imposed,
It's imposed, right.
Yeah.
Like, the Constitution is not a contract. 37 dead old guys signed it many years ago. You were not alive then. You cannot force a contract to the unborn.
Yeah.
The contract was only beholden to them.
Yeah. and you know, all of this grandeur of the contract is based upon colony.
Right, yeah.
Colonialism.
Yes, yeah. Exactly.
If you look back historically.
So that's it. I guess in the terms of, we already have our principles, is we find it the wrong and immoral to initiate that force. Government contradicts that, or to begin with. It compromises our principles. It misleads us into compromising, to legitimize it, to participate in the political process, because it only knows how to solve problems through violence. So instead of removing government, instead of turning to our community, you know, we universalize our moralities, right? If it's wrong and immoral to initiate force, it should be wrong and immoral for anyone, no matter what title they hold or color costume they wear, right? It's wrong and immoral for any individual to initiate force, right? But unfortunately, that's how government funds itself, how it projects itself, and how it maintains that monopoly on law.
Yeah, and how it harvests its citizenship as well. You know?
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. It harvests us nothing but tax cattle to them. These are nothing but tax farms to the political rulers. The politician, that's not a real job. His job dictating, ruling your life, telling you what his opinion, what is good onto you, right? But you can't do the same with a politician. Right.
Yeah, first, you have to make your way through all of the circuits, yeah, and elections, and through all of the debates of the policy discussions,
right,
and such.
Even with cannabis, yeah, it's like a minefield to go through, right? Uh-huh. Like, even if they legalize cannabis tomorrow, like, so what? 75 years to finally have the freedom to smoke a plant? It's not a measure of success, right? Yeah. It's like, oh my God, I'm going to die a slave at that rate. It's like, to lose so many other freedoms in the same amount of time, like one step forward, 1,000 freedoms
it's
lost.
It's a landmark in the labyrinth. You
know? Yeah. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. So that's really what we're discussing here. Trying to turn away from government. I mean, not turning away from government is not turning away from the things that they provide. When people think government, they provide a service. Government has a monopoly on those services, right? Government has a monopoly on law. They have a monopoly on courts, on judges, on roads, on security. USPS delivering pieces of paper is illegal and criminal for you to create a business to compete against USPS. UPS and FedEx can only deliver packages. So they also have a monopoly on currency. That's why the dollar in your pocket today has lost over 97% of its value. It's illegal for anyone to compete and provide their own currency. They also have a monopoly here in Virginia, we all well know, ABC, monopoly on distilled spirits, right? Prohibition's still alive today. But you have no freedom to cancel or unsubscribe.
Yeah, now they just have a bureaucracy to filter it through economic purposes or
exactly.
Something.
Yeah, yeah. They're disguised to it. So they're economic development, like the baseball stadium they want to build here. No facts or evidence from the Cato Institute that says the pro sports stadiums produce these economic benefits to any society. All you do is just move the money around in Carrytown and move it over here and talk about them. Nothing more. And actually, salaries start to depreciate around those particular service industries. So that's what government is. They have a monopoly on the services you and I want. We have no freedom to cancel or unsubscribe, like Netflix or any other service. They have no freedom to compete entrepreneurially in order to say, I can provide you a better form of security that's not going to be harmful and abusive to you, right? Real contracts, man. Personally held liable for my own actions, right? No immunity. I'm not hiding behind government. I won't throw you into a cage for a victimless crime. But unfortunately, you're forced to pay for that service whether you want it or not. And that's all the government is. Very coercive, immoral. It contradicts our moral positions to begin with. Right?
And it also imposes it by the contract of our existence as Americans.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. You going to school here?
I do not, actually.
You know?
I'm a VCU applicant.
Oh, yeah? Where do you want to study?
Speaking of bureaucracy.
Where are you going now?
I'm a J. Sergeant Reynolds student, okay, presently. And so I'm fixing for that transfer through and for all the studies to continue.
Good luck, man. Good luck. Yeah, you gotta hurdle on through that. What do you want to study?
Well, I'd like to. I have this timeline for historical purposes that I'd like to study. Although, you know, I'd like to study, you know, all the varieties of sciences that I can expose myself to and interact with. You know, I'd like to study chemistry and physics, in which I can understand nuclear fission and such the origin of the expansion of the Big Bang of the universe that is supposed as the existence that we observe with our psychological capabilities of organisms. And then from there, I want to study the formation of nebulae and also the formation of galaxies and protoplanets and all of that such of oceanography, which eventually appears on the biosphere that we know as Earth.
Right.
And then biology and ecology to understand the Darwinistic process that eventually leads to an organism as intelligent, of course, not to say anything of elitism, but just of the capabilities of an organism as intelligent as we are, in which we are capable of thinking with an abstraction of our identity according to existence as a connective, integrated, functioning substance.
I would say that what separates us from other animals.
The ability to abstract a self from nature.
Yeah.
And so, what I mean, I'd like to, and that term nature for me applies to existence that is not decided by free will intelligence, such as the human organism's capabilities.
What is it decided by?
Well, it decides upon its opinion of existence. It defines existence through an observation, of course.
Right.
You know, as perception is only an extended affordance to the environment by the organism for its own advantage.
Right.
A human does not define existence as to which it organizes its function. It only defines existence as to which it can appropriate its own observation. So.
Yeah, empirically. Yeah, I mean, we have to rely on our senses to survive, right? That's awesome. So, you consider yourself a rational realist, right?
Yeah, I do. And as much as I also consider myself a goofball. And
same here.
I mean, I'd also like to study meteorology, and I'd also like to study astronomy and cosmology likewise. And
get off this planet, visit Alpha Centauri someday.
Yeah, and I'd like to study geopolitical history, and I'd like to study musical history, and theatrical history.
Busy as we
go. Oh yeah, sure.
Well, that's great. Okay, sometimes people get stuck on the idea of a social contract. Like, look, it doesn't exist, right? Yeah. You can't point to it, right? Or government, you can't point to government. Government doesn't exist. You look at a globe of the world, you don't see boundaries on there, right?
Yeah.
So countries are nothing but arbitrary lines on a piece of paper, right? So I mean, these things don't consist. They're abstract concepts.
Yeah.
They're not concrete concepts, tangible, real.
Yeah. But they surely have all of the propagandic flags.
They
that
do.
Convince us that they're tangible.
Yeah. They do. 2 + 2 = 5.
If you look at a globe without the borders drawn on it, try not to visualize the borders. It's incredible.
Oh no, and that's I'd really love to study, you know, paleogeography, so I can imagine all the formations of the continents that we know today as their political outstanding rights of thought, you know.
Right. So would you consider yourself are you free?
Yeah, by my own understanding of existence, I am free, and I believe that all time is free, and I believe that responsibility is a personal choice. And, you know, by my understanding of that which is natural according to my organismic being, I'm free. But by the understanding of my relationship to government, or government impositions, you know, I am withheld.
We are.
Yeah.
They have they put parameters on how free we can be, and I find that problematic. Yeah, I agree with you. I'm very much free. And, you know, I guess in terms that I'm allowed to be free to conduct my own affairs, unfortunately, these people who call themselves the government will approach you and say, well, we don't like what you're doing. You have to forfeit a percentage of your income, call it taxes, in order to conduct your business or affair, right? So I wouldn't say I'm free. I would say, I guess, I'm as free as they allow me to be. And I guess in that case, I'm just a prisoner.
Yeah.
Right? To that fantasy.
Yeah, sure. I mean, according to my mind, I define my observations. And I think that by my own thoughts, I am free. I could say and think anything that I wish to say and think and adventure through any of the consciousness that I may so wish to lead. But, you know, according to the abstract right and the abstract contract of society upon the enforcement of American government, of course, I am not free.
That's a beautiful statement. Yeah. To be free here is the most important, right?
Yeah, exactly. Right. I understand that I am socially obliged to relate myself to the contract of American existence.
Right.
And I also understand that, you know, America is just an observation that we name upon a map that we happen to have drawn, and our civilization depends upon for some sort of reality that we can tuck ourselves in with.
Projecting some kind of, some kind of negative abuse that occurs in their own life, and that's all that is. That's all that government is. So we're part of an organization called Liberate RVA. It's a non-political organization, so nothing to do. You're a Democrat, you're a Republican, Libertarian.
Oligarch.
Yeah. We're like, look, politics has never set us free. The fact that we're still tax slaves today implies that all the political means to achieve freedom have failed, right?
Yeah.
Looking back in the thousands of years, people, we just got to have the right government. It's like, look, it's the 21st century. I'm still a tax slave, right?
Yeah.
Politics has not worked. So we're just kind of turning away from government and trying to turn to our own community and resolve our problems or conflicts through the voluntary interactions that we already achieve in our own lives.
Yeah, and I believe that what does work according to nature is ecology.
Mm-hmm.
And ecology is, of course, the study of the relationships of organisms and ecosystems, biosphere, and the biosphere is where life exists in the known universe of space we observe. So, according to life existing, you know, on a planet where elements and where molecules are converted into cells, life exists.
Right.
So, when life exists, what works is ecology.
Alright, yeah, yeah. Alright, so you'll find like this interesting biological concepts. Like what ends up happening when you have a bottleneck effect, right? For an ecology of like cheetahs, for example, right? There was a bottleneck effect that occurred many, many, many years ago in which the different variations of strains of their cheetahs died away.
Yeah.
So you only have one particular type of cheetah that keeps reproducing within its own, I guess, genetics and produce offspring that sometimes find it difficult to survive. They find it difficult to have those rich variable traits that they need to kind of, to grow, to keep evolving. So what government does in this particular era as a monopoly is the same thing, right? There's no competition, no other variable strains that we can have to show what other kinds of services could be provided. And that's why these services tend to depreciate in quality, right?
Yeah.
Like it's like driving on the moon here in Richmond because they have a monopoly on roads, right?
Yeah.
There's no competition, there's no other variable strains of DNA to compete against, no other businesses, competitive businesses. So obviously the quality is going to depreciate, and that's what ends up happening with all government services. The cost continues to rise and quality depreciates. Like USPS, $16 billion in debt. Detroit, great example of a bottleneck effect on a monopoly of those services, right? They're like, the government has collapsed. But then I guess you'll look at it rationally, like this ends up happening over thousands of years, government keeps collapsing, so let's not, you know, reboot the matrix, right?
It's necessary to occur because it's part of the development of existence, you know?
Right.
Part of the development of life. I mean, eventually, I do believe, and I think that it's reasonable to believe, that governments and civilizations will, you know, not fail and not collapse and, you know, not burn or not conflagrate or anything, but eventually it'll convert back to ecological function.
Right.
Ecological conformity. Not to say that there's some sort of law that is righteous of ecology, but it's just, it's a natural conformity that isn't based on will. It's, I believe that it is the basis of it.
Right, and I will find though that government is the last place so you would want to maintain any kind of ecology. You know, that's why a lot of the environments are ruined. You know, you look at like the greatest polluter of industry is called the military, United States military, right? And the chaos that they ensue and leave in all these world wars that they continue to decimate populations. Why? United States itself has murdered over 30 million people since World War II, right? 1.5 million Iraqis dead, right? So I find, you know, the last thing we want to, I guess, to preserve ecology and environment are governments in itself. I mean, they don't allow you to claim ownership of land to take care of it, right? Since there's no ownership of these particular land, like federal government owns one third of the entire country, they don't have, there's no ownership to want to take care of it, right? So they lend out a lot of these lands to corporations, to like mining construction companies, for example. They don't have ownership over it, so they have no incentive to take care of it, right? So I find that to be like the last place I would want any kind of control of the environment or ecology would be under government. Right.
No.
So then that's what we're advocating. Remove government, we have thousands of competing communities, and those particular rules set like the rules of how you want to maintain those particular lands.
Yeah, and you know, I think that someone who would be attached to what is the imposed righteousness of American government would say that that's foolish anarchy.
Right.
But I mean, and someone who is pessimistic and lazy and defeatist and would rather just go buy popcorn at Kroger would probably say that that's wishful thinking. And you know, what I believe is that, you know, that's progression in thought. And progression, when faced with, you know, such situations as American government is almost, you know, feeble.
Right. Yeah. Well, it happens today that we're free market anarchists. So like in science, anions and cations, and means without, archy means rulers, like political rulers, like monarchy, one political ruler. Anarchy then means without political rulers. We can still have rules, we just don't need the political rulers of government dictating, arbitrarily deciding what is good for everyone.
Yeah.
So we can have rules, we can have all this stuff provided in a voluntary exchange.
Yeah, I think what's necessary is community.
Exactly, absolutely.
I think that the rule of law becomes considerability once communication is the function of communities and humans.
Right. Yeah, real direct communication. Absolutely.
Honest and intentional communication. And also, you know, with the intention, communication that cares to communicate.
Right.
And not just to exchange a dollar bill and go home and hide your riches or something.
Now, I find government is like the complete opposite of that. Because they'll say like, communication need your voice, but they'll say, well, voting is your voice. Like, you're not really exercising your voice. You're just pulling a lever, pushing a chat, and you're not expressing. Of course, when you come out of the confession booth and people say, who did you vote for? And they're like, oh, how dare you? That's a personal issue. No communication, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And that's the propagandized version, you know, trying to silence you by saying voting is your communication, is your voice, when it's not. So you don't exercise it. You have an entire culture of people that don't exercise, and we become very isolationist within our own community.
Yeah, I think that there was a lot of potential in the origins of American history of democracy for the type of community that we're mentioning. And I think it was especially prophesied by Walt Whitman. But I think that, you know, especially I'm not too familiar with American history. It's something that I'm anticipating the study much more, but I think that around much of the industrialization, around much of the world wars, and around much of the eve of the 20th century, you know, you saw a lot of the isolation of the riches, and you saw a lot of the stratification of the socioeconomic classes. And
that actually happened in two areas of American history. There's 1913 with Federal Reserve banks first, and then the second one is 1971 when the dollar went completely flat. Because what happens when you have a completely flat dollar and printing press is so inflation comes naturally with printed currency, right? That's just general knowledge. But if you don't know there's a new dollar in the economy, then there's really no reason to assume that there's an overinflated price. So the more the dollar gets spent, the more the inflation becomes apparent. So there's only one person who never actually has to deal with the inflation of a new dollar, and that's the first person who spends the new dollar. So what the Federal Reserve Bank does is they'll print new money, hold it in reserves and banks, then you have people who have a lot of money, like bankers, that get to hold all that new money, and then they spend it without the consequences of inflation. That's all passed on to us.
Yeah, and then that would be the elite of the oligarchy that is proposed as the American existence today.
Right. To the government, they have all of that power. And they bribe those officials, lie before those officials. Yeah.
Oh, exactly. All lobbying with policymaking, with legislation, and, you know, with elections, too, you have the convincing aspect that, you know, voting is so valuable and integral to the American spirit. But then again, you know, once the American spirit is expressed, it is all in the waiting line as the elites have that, you know, quick fix to the front of the desk. You know?
There's some nothing but bread and circuses.
There's some pragmatic issues with that, too. All that new money is backed by real wealth. So every job and every business, everything started with that new money is going to bust eventually.
Yeah, and speaking of busting, I'm seeing a lot of tension, and I'm observing with a lot of fear what's occurring in Ukraine presently.
Oh, yeah.
And all of the rhetoric that's being not necessarily shared, but, you know, kind of thrown like spears from Russia to the U.S., from U.S. to Russia, NATO, and with all of the, and then, you know, with all of the UN dismissing Russia now being the big seven instead of the big
eight. That's right.
it's scary. And all of the paratroopers from the United States arriving in Poland for rehearsals of their drills and such.
This is this exercise.
And all the exercises around the border of Ukraine of the Russian military men.
Yeah, I mean, we have some stuff, same thing happens here. You have Department of Homeland Security buying like a million rounds of ammunition for what? Homeland Security, right?
Department of Education buys ammo.
Yeah, Department of Education buys ammo. You have, so like in the Boston Marathon, right? That bombing that occurred over a year ago, they call that a terrorist act. But like the drone bombing of children and weddings overseas,
they call that justice.
And collateral damage, right?
Yeah. No, and you know, Barack Obama recently said that the United States is the only superpower, and the spying that they practice, he legitimized as an act of defense.
Right.
And he said it's necessary to the American security, which, once again, he said, is of the only superpower.
You'd have to be insane to want to invade the United States. It's crazy. I think we're actually any
we already are invaded. Yeah, we're losing our freedoms. Yeah.
No, but I mean, Barack Obama legitimized and he affirmed and he justified the National Security Agency's spying regime as a necessary defense of the only superpower.
But
of
then
globe.
Also consider the position Barack Obama's in. Remember, he's a politician.
Oh no, exactly.
So it's almost like
that's implied. You know.
Yeah. How seriously can you take it? So it's not really a logical argument against Barack Obama. Contradict yourself, you're a politician.
It's really just evidence to support our opinions and discussion. Yeah. You know?
Well, cool. My name is Cal.
My name is Nick. Cal, you said?
Yeah, Cal. Yeah. Pleasure to meet you, Nick.
Nice to meet you, Matt.
Thank you. Would you like some pamphlets?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not too familiar.
This is so cool.
More apolitical functions.
I love your rational mind here. That is awesome.
No, I mean, I'm really, I was thinking that I would approach with the inquiry of what is moral, and we would have a Socratic impasse, but you were really astute with that. And so I'm thankful that we're able to share these rapid and these thoughtful discussions.
Thank you. Yeah, I feel like this is our Greek forum here to have these philosophical discussions.
It's a great Lyceum to share.